Welcome to Doggo.jl, your home for wholesome Julia tutorials. One of the great things about a computer is that you can program it to perform many different tasks for you. But in some cases, you don't want your computer to perform all of those tasks at the same time. Instead, you may want your computer to perform certain tasks only if certain conditions are met. And in other cases, you may want your computer to perform a single task, but to repeat that task multiple times. You, as the programmer, are able to determine which tasks are performed, in which order they're performed, and for how long they're performed, by using a set of tools collectively referred to as control flow. Control flow introduces the concept of logic and automation, which are a couple of key concepts that differentiates your computer from other machines. Over the next several chapters, we'll explore some of the built-in control flow tools that come included with Julia. Let's start with an example of a conditional evaluation. I'm in VS Code, and I've already created a new .jl file. And I've also launched the Julia REPL by using Alt-J, then Alt-O. Conditional evaluation is a control flow tool that tells your computer to perform a certain task only if certain conditions are met. Let's start by setting up some scenarios, also known as conditions. Before you execute these lines of code, let's talk about them. The first line of code is an example of destructuring assignment using tuples. In Julia, using the parentheses is optional for destructuring assignment, so this line of code is the same as this line of code with the parentheses. The first line is declaring a variable named x and assigning the value 1 to it. In addition, it's declaring a variable named y and assigning the value 2 to it. The next line of code is another example of destructuring assignments using tuples without the parentheses. The second line of code will swap the values between the variables x and y so that the value contained in the variable named x will mutate from 1 to 2, and the value contained in the variable named y will mutate from 2 to 1. This last line of code will mutate the value contained in the variable named x to the value contained in the variable named y. In other words, the value contained in the variable named x will mutate from 2 to 1, so that both x and y are equal to 1. For now, let's comment out the last two lines of code and only execute the first line of code, so that x equals 1 and y equals 2. Recall that you can toggle the comments on and off by using control forward slash. Now let's set up three different tasks for your computer to perform. In Julia, you can assign a function to another function name, just like you can with variables. The only difference is that you need to include a set of parentheses at the end of the new function names. When you hit Shift-Enter for each line, nothing happens. I'll explain what generic function with one method means in a future chapter. For now, what you need to know is that you just created three new functions named task 1, 2, and 3, and made these new functions available for use in memory. Now comes the fun part. You don't want your computer to perform all three tasks at the same time. What you really want is to set up a conditional evaluation, so your computer can use some logic to determine which task to perform. In Julia, you have a couple of options when it comes to conditional evaluation. One option is to use the if expression. To create an if expression, use if, else, end. After if and else if, include a conditional statement that will evaluate either true or false. Now before hitting Shift Enter, let's talk about this code and try to anticipate what's going to happen. So in English, this code can be read, if x is greater than y, then perform task 1. Else, if x is less than y, then perform task 2. Otherwise, perform task 3. Here's a visualization of the code. Based on this diagram, your computer can use logic to determine which task to perform. In the current scenario, x is equal to 1, and y is equal to 2, so x is less than y. Based on this code, your computer should perform task 2. Task 2 is a function that will display 1 is less than 2. Let's execute the code to see what happens. As predicted, in the REPL, you'll see the output 1 is less than 2. Now let's go back up to the top of the code and swap the values between the variables x and y. The output 2, 1 means that the value contained in the variable named x has mutated from 1 to 2, and the value contained in the variable named y has mutated from 2 to 1. In other words, the values have been swapped. Now let's go back down to the if expression to predict what will happen. Since the value contained in x is now greater than the value contained in y, then this code should perform task 1. Let's rerun the if expression to see what happens. In the REPL, you'll see 2 is greater than 1. So the if expression works. It performs a different task based on a different condition. So there's no need for you to rewrite your code for different conditions. Now, let's go back up to the top of the code and try the third condition. Since the value contained in the variable named y is 1, this code mutates the value contained in the variable named x from 2 to 1. In other words, both x and y are equal to 1. Now let's go back down to the if expression to predict what will happen. Since x is not greater than y, and x is not less than y, then this code should perform task 3, since there's no other option. Let's rerun the if expression to see what happens. In the REPL, you'll see 1 is equal to 1. So the if expression worked again. It performed a third task based on a third condition, while using the same code. Pretty cool, right? Now, when you're using an if expression, only the if and end keywords are required. Using else and else if are optional. But using if, else, end will allow you to count for a lot of different conditions. So this syntax is a handy one to have in your toolkit. So that's the basics of using an if expression in Julia. In the next chapter, you'll learn what a ternary operator is and how to use it in Julia.